Welcome back. With us now is Dr. Jeff Lovinger, who is with Eagles Landing OBGYN. Welcome to the show.
Thank you.
Now, you guys are a staple here in our community. How long have you guys been around?
We've been in the community a little over 20 years now.
Wow. We've certainly heard your name several times. I'm sure you have watched a lot of babies who you delivered just grow in the community.
Oh, yes. Yeah. In fact, at this point now, you're delivering people who you've delivered.
Yeah, I was just going to say that. Yeah.
That's true. That's pretty wild. That's true at that point, yeah.
How does that make you feel? I mean, that's kind of cool.
It's pretty amazing. It is. It's pretty interesting.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so you actually are a new location maybe to some, but not really new. You've been there 5 or 6 years now, and the practices have even grown.
Yes, currently we have about 7 physicians, and we have 1 nurse practitioner and then 1 midwife. And we're about to add our 8th physician starting in August, Dr. Cruz.
Mm-hmm. Is that because of the demand getting greater or additional services? Or
it is the demand. I mean, there's lots of babies being born down in the south side here, and so there's lots of patients.
Yeah.
Good. Well, we're still one of the fastest growing counties.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And we definitely you fit right
see
into
that.
That,
we
right?
see that, yes.
Well, you help that that math, right?
And you know, and that's where I kind of wanted to go with, you know, the answer to that, because I mean, it's still a vibrant community. You know, still young people moving in, and you know, and you guys are obviously experiencing that.
Yeah, and again, with lots of young people comes lots of babies, so
exactly.
We keep very busy,
which is good for the hospital too.
Yep.
Yay!
Yep.
That's right, absolutely.
All right, so what are you here to talk to us about today?
Just going to talk a little bit about pelvic prolapse. That's one of the specialties of myself and Dr. Rao. So that's what we're
doing. I mean, how do we know we have that, and what is it?
Well, pelvic prolapse is is caused by a defect in the support structures in the pelvis. And there is normally a certain amount of tissue that helps to support the organs in the pelvis. And when those tissues are damaged, then it can lead to pelvic prolapse.
Mm-hmm. What would be the symptoms of?
There's different symptoms. Sometimes people will have pelvic pain. Sometimes they'll have like a pressure sensation in the pelvis. Sometimes they'll actually see something coming out of the pelvis. And other symptoms include problems with their bladder, with difficulty either leaking urine when they cough or laugh, difficulty with urination, or even difficulty with bowel movements.
Now, you said defect or damage. I mean, what causes that? I mean, is there a defect from...
Don't say age.
Is it an age thing?
Well,
where are we going with that?
Unfortunately, one of the most common causes is one of the joys of motherhood. So with pregnancy, you know, the pelvic structures obviously expand a lot. And with delivery, those tissues a lot of times are damaged. And even though that repairs somewhat after childbirth, it doesn't repair completely. Mm-hmm. So over time, as we do get older, a lot of our tissue also gets weaker, and so that it tends to just present itself a little bit later in life.
Mm-hmm. Hmm. Okay, so would it be true in saying maybe the more children you have, the more likely are you to have
usually
habits?
So. The more children, also the bigger the babies. So if you tend to have very large babies, again, that stretches the pelvic support so much that it does cause more damage. But we also see people who've never had children, just with age, those tissues can weaken.
You just mentioned something that I wanted to ask. You know, as our population gets older and grows and gets larger and stuff, is the average size of the baby getting bigger?
It is.
Yeah.
Average size of the baby.
Why is that?
Interesting.
Well, our population is a little heavier at this point, and the heavier the mother is to begin with tends to be the bigger the baby is also. So they do tend to get bigger.
Okay. Now, when a lady is pregnant, do you suggest a certain number of pounds that she should gain no matter what size she is initially?
Now, actually, that has really changed recently. The American College of Obstetrics has really changed recommendations recently to try and limit weight gain. You know, if somebody who's normal weight, then usually it's about 25 to 35 pounds. If they're underweight, they should gain more than 35 pounds. And if they're overweight, depending on how overweight, now the limitations are anywhere from 12 to 15 pounds,
oh,
which
wow.
is a big difference.
Wow, yes, a huge difference.
Yeah.
So back to the prolapse. Is there, when you feel the symptoms coming on, are there things that you can do before going to see the physician or before having a medical intervention, or how does that work?
Really, the best thing to do, you know, if there's symptoms, is to get in with your physician to have them evaluate and kind of identify the problem. Mm-hmm. There are different types of prolapse and different degrees of prolapse. So depending on, you know, again, what symptoms are and how bad it is, there's different options.
Is there any pain related to these symptoms?
There can be. A lot of women complain of like just a heaviness in the pelvis or pressure sensation.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And then the bladder and
There is something that can be done for this.
So we're going to fix it. What do we do?
Well, again, it depends on the degree of the prolapse. Sometimes pelvic floor exercises can help strengthen the pelvic floor. Other times it's a surgical correction. And again, Dr. Rao and myself are very experienced in extensive pelvic reconstructive surgery.
And how long is the recovery time for?
Usually about 4 to 6 weeks after surgery.
Yeah. So this is a major surgery.
It is. It's a big surgery.
Sure.
It is.
All right. Well, we're glad to know we have an answer for you right here in Henry County. If you're having any of these symptoms, please give Eagles Landing OBGYN a call. And Dr. Lovinger will be happy to see you and evaluate your specific situation. We'll be right back.
Welcome back. With us now is Dr. Amanda Phillips, who is also with Eagles Landing OBGYN. Welcome to the show.
Thank you very much.
Now, this is your first time with us, so let's tell everyone out there in TV land a little bit about you.
Well, I've been practicing obstetrics and gynecology in the area for about 5 years, and I've been practicing since training for 8 years.
Okay.
So you know your stuff.
Yes.
We have a specific topic we're going to discuss with you today. Minimally, am I saying that right?
Say that again. Case,
minimally?
Minimally.
Minimally. I don't like that word. but I do like it
less,
in this case.
Less.
Yes. Invasive hysterectomy.
Yes. It's a great way to go. It's very different from traditional hysterectomies. With minimally invasive hysterectomies, you're going to experience less pain, less scarring, less incisions on your abdomen. So it's a optimal way to go if you need to have a hysterectomy.
Is there a particular candidate that makes one eligible for that versus the traditional way of treating a hysterectomy?
Yes, of course, each patient is taken on a case-by-case basis. You have to evaluate them for any medical problems, mm-hmm. their actual body size, how big their uterus is, and what all needs to be done during a particular procedure. So there's a process that we go through in selecting the appropriate person to get that type of surgery.
Wow. Are you finding more and more people are eligible to go this route?
Yes, I think when you really look at the patient individually, I think most patients can have a minimally invasive hysterectomy.
And that would also, I guess, stand to reason as the process becomes more defined or more mainstream. I mean, you're able to apply it to more individuals?
Yes. And I think people actually come to you and ask for it. They've done their research on the internet.
Yeah.
You know, they've read about it.
Doctor.
They want to, you know, they want the least amount of incisions on their stomach as possible. They want to be able to still wear that two-piece bikini.
Right.
So, you know, they want to, you know, be cut the least amount. So I think that more people, and a lot of people want to go back to work right away. Mm-hmm. So this allows them to get back to work and back to their daily routine in a quicker manner.
How long has this procedure been going on?
It's been going on for a long time. It's just been with more instruments and more tools that are available to surgeons, we've been able to further advance it and do more of them. People are less scared to go into someone who's had prior surgery and still perform the surgery on those patients as well.
Now, again, from an age perspective, I mean, is this an age-oriented?
No, it's more about what surgeries they've had in the past, mm-hmm. how big their womb, what we call a uterus, mm-hmm. is, you know, what actual procedures we have to perform when we actually go there and, you know, perform it. So, no, it's not really age. It can, you know, some people's medical problems may determine what type of surgery they need to have done, but it's not really an age, per se, that determines it. It's you know, we look at each patient based on their factors and what's going on with them. Yeah. So I think it's more of something that's discussed with each patient individually with the physician, and we determine, yes, you know, you would be a good candidate versus no, I think we should go a different route.
Okay, one more time, let's go over the differences in that procedure and the traditional hysterectomy?